Lyndon Baines Johnson, better known simply as LBJ, was the 36th President of the United States. He was the Vice President of another man who is better known just by his initials, JFK. He became President in 1963 when JFK was assassinated. LBJ was a Democrat from Texas, something which is pretty rare in modern times. Before becoming President, he had been a representative and a senator, something only a handful of other presidents have ever done. LBJ was extremely ambitious. Of course, most people who become president are, but LBJ went above and beyond. Because of this, he didn't really like being vice president because the vice president doesn't really do anything. LBJ attempted to change this with little success. He tried to make it so that the vice president had the authority of the Senate Majority Leader, but other Democrats hated the idea and wouldn't go along with it. Even his supporters in Congress were totally against it, since it was such an obvious power grab. Unable to get more power from Congress, LBJ tried to get more power in the executive branch that he actually belonged to. He asked JFK to sign an executive order giving himself general supervision over national security issues that would require all government agencies to cooperate fully with the vice president in the carrying out of these assignments. This would have been a huge change and likely would have made LBJ one of the most influential vice presidents ever. JFK wasn't interested and instead wrote up a basically meaningless letter that just asked LBJ to look over national security policies instead. But this wasn't the last of LBJ's attempts to expand the little power he had as vice president. He requested to be given an office right next to the Oval Office and have his own full-time staff in the White House, just like the president. JFK turned this down as well. A lot of people in the Kennedy White House did not like LBJ. JFK's brother Robert F. Kennedy notably hated him. The only reason the Kennedys kept LBJ on the campaign ticket the second time was because they thought that if they went and found a new VP, they could lose some Southern votes. LBJ, the Texan, had always been popular down there. JFK's brother Robert said of Johnson that he tells so many lies that he convinces himself after a while he's telling the truth. He just doesn't recognize truth or falsehood. The White House staff made fun of how crude and country he was compared to the preppy president. Congressman Tip O'Neill later said that JFK's cabinet had a disdain for Johnson that they didn't even try to hide. They actually took pride in snubbing him. JFK himself, however, knew that it would not be politically savvy to go around insulting your own vice president. He told his staff, "I can't afford to have my vice president, who knows every reporter in Washington, going around saying we're all screwed up, so we're going to keep him happy." This was probably a good strategy, especially considering how many skeletons JFK had in his closet. Kennedy appointed LBJ to various jobs in order to keep him happy and busy, such as the Committee of Equal Employment Opportunities. He also went on all kinds of diplomatic missions and was given control over all appointments involving his home state of Texas. Kennedy also made LBJ the chairman of the National Aeronautics and Space Council. When Russia beat the U.S. to putting the first man in space, the president asked LBJ to evaluate America's space program and come up with something that would let them beat the Russians back. LBJ recommended a program that would attempt to beat the Soviets to the moon. He was ultimately right that this would be a good idea, but JFK probably didn't put him in charge because of his great space insights. It's thought that he was probably put in the position so that if the whole space thing turned out to be a total failure, he would have someone to blame. LBJ took the presidential oath of office on Air Force One the same day Kennedy was assassinated. It was so soon after the event that Jackie Kennedy still had her husband's blood on her suit. He felt that an immediate show of transition of power was necessary for the sake of stability. At least, that's the official version of the story. There are, of course, numerous conspiracy theories about who really killed JFK that allege government involvement. These conspiracies existed at the time as well, prompting LBJ to create the Warren Commission to investigate JFK's assassination. The commission unanimously concluded that the shooter, Lee Harvey Oswald, had acted alone. LBJ likely hoped that this would put the issue to rest, which of course it didn't. Today, only 19% of Americans believe that Lee Harvey Oswald acted alone, according to a Gallup poll. There wasn't much for LBJ to do as vice president, but as president, he proved to be highly effective at getting his agenda accomplished. He is one of the most influential presidents in history. passing the Civil Rights Act, the Voting Rights Act, Medicare, the Public Broadcasting Act, and initiating the Great Society and the War on Poverty. One president doing so much seems nearly impossible in our modern hyper-partisan era of congressional gridlock. So how did he become one of the most legislatively active presidents ever, when he couldn't even figure out how to get along with JFK's brother? One reason LBJ managed to get so much done is what came to be known as the Johnson treatment. LBJ's persuasion tactics were legendary. Mary McGrory, a journalist at the time, wrote that they were an incredible potent mixture of persuasion, badgering, flattery, threats, reminders of past favors, and future advantages. LBJ had no problem bullying people into getting them to do what he wanted in order to further his agenda. For instance, LBJ wanted Georgia Senator Dick Russell on the Warren Commission, but he knew he didn't want to be on it. The normal thing to do would be to ask him why not, or maybe even to just go find someone else. But that wasn't LBJ's style. LBJ publicly announced that Russell would be on the commission without asking him, and then just bullied him into doing it on a lengthy phone call. Later, he would steamroll Russell again on the Civil Rights Act. Russell was a serious segregationist who opposed the bill, but LBJ told him, "Dick, I love you and I owe you, but I'm going to run over you if you challenge me on this civil rights bill." Russell would later boycott the Democratic convention in protest. LBJ was well known for not caring about personal space. He would get right up in people's faces and loom over them. At 6'3.5", LBJ is the second tallest president ever, so he spent a lot of time looking down at people. In case you're wondering, Abraham Lincoln is the tallest at 6'4". Most people simply aren't willing to endlessly hound people like LBJ was. He was a big fan of telephone conversations and had 72 different phone lines installed at his ranch in Texas. He made dozens of calls every day and was even known to use multiple phones at once. I imagine he probably would have been a huge fan of the internet. One of the other things he enjoyed doing at his ranch was driving guests around in his Lincoln Continental at 90 miles per hour while drinking whiskey from a paper cup. He also had an amphibious car, and he would occasionally pretend to accidentally drive into the lake to freak them out. Many of the conversations that took place on those phone lines were not pleasant for the person on the other end. George Reedy, who was LBJ's own press secretary, later said of LBJ's negotiation tactics, "As a human being, he was a miserable person, a bully, sadist, lout, and egotist. His lapses from civilized conduct were deliberate and usually intended to subordinate someone else to his will. Were there nothing to look at save LBJ's personal relationships with other people, it would be merciful to forget him altogether. But there is much more to look at. He may have been a son of a bitch, but he was a colossal son of a bitch. He was capable of inspiring strong attachments even with people who knew him for what he was." Evidently then, there were those who liked LBJ despite his bullying ways, and his bullying ways went way beyond aggressive telephone calls and leaning over people menacingly. He would have White House aides and reporters follow him into the bathroom rather than just take a break and come back like a normal person. He would just carry on the conversation while he was on the toilet, and it did not embarrass him at all. It was weird sort of power play that I'm pretty sure you couldn't get away with today. Sometimes it wasn't even enough for the person to accompany him to the bathroom. McGeorge Bundy, LBJ's national security advisor, stood in the corner of the bathroom with his back to the president when Johnson insisted that they continue their conversation there. But LBJ actually asked him to come stand right next to him by the toilet. Whatever sort of mind game LBJ was playing here, he was clearly totally committed to it. Another even stranger LBJ bathroom anecdote is the time he peed on the leg of a Secret Service agent who had been assigned to follow him in there. When the agent noticed, LBJ simply said, "That's all right, son, it's my prerogative." Which I guess just means, I'm the president, I can do whatever I want. Biographies of LBJ are full of not only these sorts of strange trips to the bathroom, but also of tales of LBJ's penis. He reportedly once asked a White House staff member, "Have you ever seen anything as big as this?" After finishing up at the urinal, whilst brandishing his penis at him, he referred to it as jumbo, and if you worked for him, there was always a chance that you might just randomly have to see it. LBJ even had a special showerhead that was aimed directly at his penis for some reason. If LBJ had been president in this century, there likely would have been innumerable sexual harassment cases against him. Like his predecessor Kennedy, LBJ liked to sleep around. He once joked that he had banged more women on accident than JFK had on purpose. Claiming to have cheated on your wife more than your assassinated former boss isn't exactly the classiest moves. It's also unclear to me how exactly you can accidentally have sex with someone. Like Kennedy, Johnson's affairs were basically an open secret that the journalist just left alone. His wife almost certainly knew that for much of his presidency, he was sleeping with Alice Glass and Helen Gahagan Douglas. No, this wasn't the Alice Glass from Crystal Castles. What made his affair with Alice Glass so risque was that she was involved with one of his biggest political donors. So the whole thing could have been a major impact on LBJ's finances if he had found out. She would eventually break up with the president over her opposition to the Vietnam War, something which would cause LBJ just a few other small problems as well. His other well-known mistress, Helen Gahagan Douglas, was a Broadway actress who became a congresswoman, so JFK wasn't the only person who was sleeping with actresses. Lyndon Johnson's legacy is a strange and mixed one. What should we think about the man who passed the Civil Rights Act, but was simultaneously a bully? How exactly should we judge people from different eras of history? I think we have to accept that people are capable of doing great things, but also making terrible mistakes. If you enjoyed this video, consider subscribing so you don't miss future videos. You can also like the video and let us know what you think in the comments down below.